Heavenly Father, we bless your name. We thank you for who you are and what you've done for us. You've forgiven us our sins. You've washed away the stain. You've given to us the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ, and we're here to say thank you. I pray, Lord, as we study the life of Abraham tonight, that you would use it to speak to us. Help us, Lord, in this pagan world in which we live, to follow you, to listen attentively to your voice each and every day. We thank you for your favor tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. By the way, we're in the Lenten season. We're getting ready for Easter, and the church has prepared this little song, a DVD, At the Feet of Jesus. It's a CD, actually. It's Cedar Park Worship. My daughter Sandy is, I would say, the primary vocalist on it. But beautiful songs done to accompany prayer. So if you're doing your times of prayer, these 10 songs, Jesus, I Surrender, We Fall Down, Find Me at the Feet of Jesus, at the Foot of the Cross, Because He Lives, I Can Face Tomorrow, Your Kingdom Come, All Who Are Thirsty, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. And there's quite a few songs that are on it. And so hopefully you've gotten one of these, because it's called A Soundtrack for Worship and Prayer. But I only actually heard it for the first time today myself, and I was quite impressed. My wife and I apparently raised some good kids. At least they have good singing voices, and they're good too. I don't mean to say that, but anyway, it's a beautiful piece. What's that? Get it on iTunes. That's how you get it. Thank you, Julie, for telling me that. Or you can try to fight me for this one, but I will win because I'm ferocious. All right. Well, you have the notes. We're studying, the title of it is called The Promises and Places of Abraham. That's where we started last week. We'll do another week on it tonight. And we will get pictures up there pretty soon. But I wanted to go back and revisit some of the other things we talked about last week. I don't know about you. I enjoyed it. I had coffee today with Rabbi Matt Rosenberg, and we were talking about some of these things. And I said, the best part of teaching is you get to study. And so I love the opportunity to teach because it gives me the opportunity to study. And I never study but what I learn something. And so that there's great benefit in learning the Word of God in particular. And so I did come to a couple of new things that I wanted to go back and highlight a little bit more. The first idea that I came to last week was the incredible extent to which Abraham lived in a pagan culture. I mean, we always knew from the scripture that Abraham worshipped other gods in the beginning, along with his family, his father, and others, but that he came to be a follower of God. But the extent to which that was that there was a pagan world in which Abraham lived, it struck me quite forcibly in the study last week. Haran, where Abraham, after they left Ur of the Chaldees, they go up, through the Mesopotamia and come into what is today southern Turkey in the town called Haran, which was a very pagan place. The moon god, who went by the name Sin, had his primary temple in the world in Haran. So in ancient times, many people went there, including Roman emperors, one of which was Julian the Apostate at the end of the 4th century. He goes there to pray, to consult the gods, if you will, the moon god, to find out if he was going to be successful in his effort. Though he was warned against it, he went ahead, and apparently one of the Christians in his own army assassinated him, and he was no more. But of all the cities in the Roman Empire, only one city officially mourned the death of Julian the Apostate, who tried to return the Roman Empire back to paganism, and that was Haran. I mean, that means basically, if of all of the Roman cities, Haran would have been the most decidedly pagan and the most aggressively pagan. And that's the place where Abraham connected to. And we noted, if we've got the pictures up, if you can, well, first of all, go to the first picture there. We've been kind of following this map, first picture, if you got it there, Jeff. We've been following the map. In the lower right is Ur of the Chaldees, all the way up to Haran, which is at the top. And then he's going to go all the way down to Beersheba, and then on into Egypt, even down there in the lower left. But this next picture, I got through the Institute of War, but it shows where the center of ISIS activity is in this part of the world. You know, they're trying to restore the caliphate, the governance of the Muslims in all things. But due north of Raqqa, which is their capital, about 100 miles is where Haran is. And it's about 50 miles from Kobani, which there's been major fighting there, and there is still fighting that takes place around there. And the point that I was coming to with all of that is that ISIS is as violently pagan as anything can be. You know, it's Islamic, of course, but Islam is connected to the moon god, which had its center there, and ISIS would be one of the most radical elements in it. And so this is a demonic religion. It's demonic and it's founded. I mean, Muhammad, it even says this in the Quran, believed that when he first started having visitations, that demons were appearing to him. This was Muhammad's self-confession in the beginning. And of course, he was correct about that. Those were demons that were appearing to him. Islam is a very demonic religion. It's very occultic. There are all kinds of occultic activities that take place within the world of Islam. Anywhere you go in that part of the world today, you'll find a lot of occultic activities. So when you see, you know, what does the scripture say that the devil's mission is? It's to rob, kill, and destroy. And when you see the way ISIS operates, robbing, killing, and destroying. I mean, they take great delight in killing. I mean, and even, and they publicize it and make promotional videos out of burning people in cages or drowning them in cages and all the vile things they do, not least of which would be the attack at the British Parliament this morning. I mean, this is to kill and destroy is what it's all about. And this activity is centered very near to where Abraham came from. And so I wanted to show you, let's say 1800 BC is the time of Abraham. Go forward 22 centuries to the time of Julian, the apostate, the Roman emperor, and it's still aggressively pagan. You go to another, you know, 18 centuries forward, or, you know, let's call it, well, from 4th to the 21st, so 17 centuries forward, almost an equal distance from the time of Abraham, and it is still a place of violent paganism and aggressive paganism. The point being that demons prefer one part of the world over another. And they want to go where it's friendly to them. Demons will always want to hang out where it's friendly to them. And you know, as it turns out, Seattle is a relatively friendly place for demons. You know that there has never been an actual revival in Seattle in its entire history. We have never had a revival. Most other cities in the United States have seen revivals at one time or another. Even Portland, which is a lot like Seattle, I mean, around, I think it was like 1904 or so, they had some significant revivals there. But Seattle has never had a major revival in its entire history. And it has a very long history of corruption. You know, back in the day, the pastor of the First Presbyterian Church, Mark Matthews in Seattle, actually, the police in Seattle were so corrupt that he hired his own investigators and got the scoop on the chief of police of Seattle and had him arrested. This is the pastor of First Presbyterian Church, which at the time was the largest Presbyterian church in the world with 8,800 members. But he had the chief of police arrested. But it just tells you the kind of city that Seattle has been over the decades. And I only did it once, 40 years ago, but I took the underground tour of Seattle, back in the day. And, from a spiritual point of view, it's not impressive to think about the history of Seattle. But anyway, the point being, when you see the ungodly nature of this state, and in particularly of the city of Seattle, Seattle itself has been the hub of ungodliness for a very long time. I did a poll, a statewide poll a few years ago, and I was polling, trying to figure out how to approach a Supreme Court race in Washington State, which the Lord gave me the plan for that, and it was successful. But I did statewide polling and found that only in Seattle was there support for gay marriage, for example. And at that time, and this was, what would it have been? It had been 10 years ago now, maybe. And it was already then at 61%. You didn't give above 40% in any other part of the state. So I'm just saying that Seattle, for a very long time, has been an ungodly place. And it is a haunt of demons in many regards. Haran, obviously Ur of the Chaldees would have been demonic. But when Abraham and his father moved from Ur up to Haran, they were both led out from Ur. His father, I think, had some leading from the Lord to leave there, but somehow or another he got stuck there in Haran and didn't make it out. But it was a very pagan kind of place. And yet, in spite of the paganism, Abraham chose to serve the Lord and listen for the voice of God. You can hear the voice of God any place if you will listen. And Abraham was willing to listen, heard the voice of God in a very pagan sort of place, and it encourages me that we can hear the voice of God here in the Seattle area, here in Bothell, or wherever you might be tonight. You can hear the voice of God if you will listen. And the ungodliness of a country or of a city or of a place does not take away anything from whether or not you can hear God. So these are some of the pieces that I wanted to go back to and pick up on. One of the questions that was asked last week was about Abraham's father, Terah. And I just want to go back to Genesis 11, verse 31. Terah took his son Abram, his grandson Lot, son of Haran, and his daughter-in-law, Sarai, the wife of his son Abram, and together they set out from Ur of the Chaldeans to go to Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they settled there. Terah lived 205 years, and he died in Haran. From that verse, I gather, we always think of Abraham as the being one called out, and he obviously was. But from this verse, I gather that his father was called out as well. And his father, unfortunately, even though he was called the leader of the Chaldees and made a considerable journey up to Haran, somehow or another settled. And it is a great line. This great pioneer settled in Haran. And he was unwilling to go the rest of the way. That could have been a function of his age. Let's be generous to him and say it was a function of age. Because at a certain stage in life, you're less willing to aggressively pursue distant things. That seems to be human nature. You know, there's a great story from American history along those same lines. You know, you think about the pilgrims that came to America, how courageous they were to leave their home countries, you know, the Dutch, the English, various ones, and to leave those places, brave the oceans, which would have been saying something in those little dinky wooden ships they had, and to arrive in a land that was wild and not necessarily friendly. You know, that takes a pretty brave person to be that kind of person. So these pilgrims arrive in America. They set up their business and they get established. One of the very early meetings that they had, the decision that they were trying to make and they were collectively making was, shall we build a road 5 miles from the coast inland from where they had landed? And they voted no. We should not build a road from here 5 miles inland. And their reasoning was, who in the world would want to go 5 miles inland from the coast where they had landed? That's when you know that a pioneer has become a settler. There is just something about human nature that is like that. Well, Abraham's father settled in Haran. I hope that it was not the allure of paganism and the familiarity of pagan gods that held him back. But the whole family stays in Haran until Terah dies. And then when Terah dies, Abraham feels renewed, with a new sense of authority or longing or something, because he renews the journey and they continue on toward the promised land. You know, somehow or another, and this characterizes Abraham and why he is noteworthy, because he didn't settle. He didn't accept a mid-spot. He kept on keeping on to the promises that God made. And I would just encourage you, even as I encourage myself, you always want to keep on keeping on and don't settle. You know, I was, in church on Sunday, and I'm praying to the Lord. I said, Lord, give me something useful to do. I don't want to do nothing. I want to keep doing the Lord's work. It's not necessarily going to be the same. You know, I was telling the rabbi this morning that when you reach a certain age, as I did here, and I told the congregation here that my preaching was going to change. I was going to give much more of the scripture and less of application because, you know, looking at the world through the eyes of a 65-year-old, now a 67-year-old, is a lot different than a 35-year-old. You have different interests, you know. And you need to keep it young and vital, you know. And so I said, as I told you all back then, if you were listening, I said, I'm going to mainly preach the Bible, and it's up to you to make the application. You know, don't apply it the way I would apply it, because at my stage of life, I'm looking at it differently than a person trying to raise a family and do that sort of thing. And so you have to hear the Word of God and interpret it. And the rabbi, he was saying the same thing, because he said, he's a Christian rabbi, pastors Restoration Church up in Seattle. But in any case, he said he does the same, even though he's a young man. Well, anyway, Abraham didn't settle. He kept on pressing on, even though he was, as it turns out, fairly old himself at that time. So Abraham is blessed by the Lord. He is given great promises of the land, something which is renewed in all of the Old Testament chapters, books of the first five books of the Old Testament. It's something which is renewed again and again. But the fact that God's blessing was upon Abraham did not prevent family difficulties from causing a problem. And they get there, and pretty soon there's a problem between Abraham and Lot. Verse 5 reads, "Now Lot, who was moving about with Abram, also had flocks and herds and tents. But the land could not support them while they stayed together, for their possessions were so great that they were not able to stay together." You know, if you've got a lot of sheep, if you know your American history, sheep herders and cow herders don't necessarily get along, because sheep eat the grass a lot shorter than cows do, and it creates a bit of a problem. But certainly in that area, where you do need to keep moving the crops or the herds, because, you know, it just doesn't produce that much grass year-round. And so there was a conflict, essentially, over the grass. But the land would not support them while they stayed together, for their possessions were so great. Verse 7, "And quarreling arose between Abram's herdsmen and the herdsmen of Lot. The Canaanites and Perizzites were also living in the land at that time. So Abram said to Lot, 'Let's not have any quarreling between you and me, or between your herdsmen and mine, for we are brothers. Is not the whole land before you? Let's part company. If you go to the left, I'll go to the right. If you go to the right, I'll go to the left.' Lot looked up and saw the whole plain of the Jordan as well watered, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt toward Zoar. This was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. So Lot chose for himself the whole plain of the Jordan and set out toward the east. The two men parted company. Abram lived in the land of Canaan, while Lot lived among the cities of the plain and pitched his tents near Sodom. Now the men of Sodom were wicked and were sinning greatly against the Lord." This next picture, I didn't have a good picture of my own, so I borrowed from the internet. This one came from BibleWalks.com. But, you know, when you look out over the well-watered plain of the Jordan, this is what you see. This is the Jordan River Valley, the green part. Then you see those brown sedimentary hills there in the foreground. And then you see above that a green space that would also be part of the Jordan River Valley, but before, you know, the erosion and all of that. And then the hills in the distance would be the east bank of the Jordan. It would be Gilead, modern-day Jordan, is where it would be. And so from the Israeli side, you can look out and see this beautiful valley, the Jordan River Valley, and it's full of greenery and all of that. These next pictures here, the next picture is the view from Belvoir, which means beautiful view in French. And this is actually a Crusader fortress that was built up on top. But there you can see you're up on the hills. The West Bank would be these hills of Judea. So there's like two spines that run north and south. The hills of Judea and Samaria that run north and south. And then on the other side over there in the Jordan, the hills over there, there's another spine that kind of runs down there. But from these hills up here, we're in Israel, looking down onto the Jordan River Valley. You know, from here, if I'm a sheep herder or a goat herder, I've got lots of flocks and animals, I look down there and I say, you know what, looks pretty green down there. Jericho is, has lots of water. There's lots of water down there. My friend Tassir Abu Sada, who has been here, used to work for Arafat, Palestinian, used to be a Muslim, now he's a Christian. But he runs a ministry down there in Jericho. And the last time I was there, I went with him to the well that he had. But he's got a well that pumps out an enormous source of water. And so he has developed a water company, essentially, as part of his ministry there. So they bottle water and now distribute it all over. But it comes out of Jericho, which is, 1,200 feet below sea level, but it's down there in the bottom of the Jordan River Valley, and there is an enormous amount of water. I forget the amount of water he told me that they could get, but there's a huge aquifer down there. And so they're pumping out an enormous amount of water, lots and lots of water down in the Jericho or in the Jordan River Valley, of which Jericho is part of it. You remember the story of Elisha and the turning the water into sour water into sweet water. Well, that sweet water is now filling the coffers of the Christian ministry that Tasir Abu Sada runs down there. And so, all these 2,800 years later, that water is still good and still doing the Lord's work. So it's kind of cool. The next picture is similar. That shows you in the foreground Belvoir, the kind of castle or crusader fortress that it is. But you see again, and this is the view that Abraham and Lot would have had. They would have been able to look down from Bethel, Ai, from the hills of Judea, and see all the way to the Dead Sea, see the Jordan River Valley, and as the scripture says here, Lot said it looked like the garden of the Lord. It's a well-watered plain. And so Lot says to Abraham, okay, thank you for the offer. We don't want to have a contest between us. I'll take the plain of the Jordan River Valley. So he takes his animals and people and heads to the east, and Abraham stays in the high country. Well, immediately after this happens, Lot separates himself off. In Genesis 13, God comes again to Abraham, and he renews the promise to Abraham. God told Abraham to look in all four directions. Look east, toward the Jordan River Valley, toward the hills in modern-day Jordan. Look to the south, toward Hebron. Look to the north in the West Bank. Look to the west, and from those places, I would guess in a clearer day, when there's less pollution that day, that it may have been possible for Abraham to see all the way to the Mediterranean and to be able to see the Mediterranean. So he could have seen literally hundreds of square miles from those hilltop places where he was. This next picture shows you a little bit of that. Here we are in the Herodium, and Herodium is actually, it's higher than the Mount of Olives, but not a lot higher. And you can see the Dead Sea from the Herodium, but you can see great distances, as you can see. So this is probably 6 miles south of Jerusalem, but from these hilltops, you can see vast distances. So when Lot separates, God renews the promise of the land to Abraham and to his descendants. And this is a statement which is repeated again and again. And it figures prominently in the scripture in those early books of the Bible. So, for example, in Exodus chapter 6, in the telling of the Exodus, it's reviewed there. Exodus chapter 6, God also said to Moses, I am the Lord. I appeared to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob as God Almighty, but by my name, the Lord, I did not make myself known to them. I also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan where they lived as aliens. Moreover, I have heard the groaning of the Israelites whom the Egyptians are enslaving, and I have remembered my covenant. Therefore, say to the Israelites, I am the Lord. I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. I will free you from being slaves to them, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment. I will take you as my own people, and I will be your God. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God, who brought you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians, and I will bring you to the land I swore with uplifted hand to give to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. I will give it to you as a possession. I am the Lord. So it's time for the Exodus. It's time for Israel to be delivered from the Pharaohs. And what does God say? Even though 400 years have passed and it's time for the Exodus, God says to Moses and to Joseph, I made a promise to Abraham, to Isaac, and Jacob. I swore with an upraised hand, that is, you know, taking the oath, I swore with an upraised hand that that land belongs to them. And so I'm going to take you out of Egypt. I'm going to deliver you in the Exodus, and I'm going to return you to the land I swore an oath to give to Abraham, Isaac, and to Jacob. And so you're going to go out, and I'm going to deliver you. So you can see that the promises that God made to Abraham there at Bethel and elsewhere in the book of Exodus, he made it in Genesis, now in Exodus he's repeating it, and it's an essential component of the reasoning that God uses in saying to the Israelis who are captive in Egypt at the time, I'm going to deliver you. And you should notice in that passage in Exodus chapter 6 in verse 4 that God made the covenant with them. And who are the them in this case? Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And I highlight that as in contrast, it was to Abraham and to Isaac and not Ishmael, to Jacob and not Esau. He made the promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They are, as we call them, the children of promise. Well, this promise that God made to Abraham was consequential. And it was consequential beyond just the life of Abraham. And so the point of that being, the promise didn't die with Abraham. When Abraham died, the contract didn't run out. Look at 2 Kings chapter 13, for example, verse 22. Hazael, king of Aram, basically Syria, oppressed Israel throughout the reign of Jehoahaz. But the Lord was gracious to them and had compassion and showed concern for them because of his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. To this day, written in 2 Kings, he has been unwilling to destroy them or banish them from his presence. So the writer of 2 Kings rehearses the promises to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And he says, you know, to this day, writing in 2 Kings, God has been unwilling to destroy Israel because of the promises made to Abraham. And I cite that to show you that these promises didn't expire. It wasn't until death do you part, but it was beyond that. Reading on. Verse 14, the Lord said to Abram after Lot had parted from him, lift up your eyes from where you are and look north and south, east and west. All the land that you see, I will give to you and your offspring forever. See the word there, forever? Not just in your lifetime or their lifetimes, but forever. I will make your offspring like the dust of the earth, so that if anyone could count the dust, then your offspring could be counted. Go, walk through the length and breadth of the land, for I am giving it to you. So Abram moved his tents and went to live near the great trees, the oaks of Mamre at Hebron, where he built an altar to the Lord. Next picture there just shows you a bit of the walking that Abraham would have made. And this is, I'm showing you where Herodian is over there on the right. This is the territory where Abraham did his walking. So he goes down to Hebron, a city which was there in great antiquity and which remains today. And so I would like to take you to Hebron. Hebron is a very important place because Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are buried in Hebron, along with their wives, with the exception of Rachel, who is buried between Jerusalem and Bethlehem. There's a place that's been marked out from antiquity. It's still observed today where she was buried. You can visit it today, her burial place. And there's references to it. There was a column that was there. Throughout the centuries, there are references to that particular location. But other than her, all of these people we've been talking about are buried in Hebron. And it would be the home base, if you will, that Abraham had. And so when his wife dies, that's when he buys a piece of land. And he pays dearly for it. The land that God promised to him, he has to buy in this case. And if you know Middle Eastern ways, Abraham, first the guy says, I'll give it to you. And that's the opening negotiation, but that's never the price. And there's a counter, but Abraham essentially pays the excessive price. He pays way more than it's worth because on this one, he's not going to negotiate. Because what he is essentially doing, he is making a deposit on the promise that God made him. That if God said, this is going to be yours, then okay, this is where I'm being buried. And where you're buried, that's putting down deep roots. It's significant that my burial place is right out there in the Chapel of the Resurrection. I bought it a long time ago. And I said, this is where I'm going to be buried. These are going to be my roots right there. It's where my father and mother are buried. It's where my wife's father is buried and where her mother will eventually be buried. We're all going to be buried there. And so that's when you say, okay, this is my place right here. This is where we belong. So when you go to Hebron today, which you can do, first of all, let me show you a couple of pictures here. This first picture is there is a place down there with a fence around it. It's an oak tree. It's an extremely old oak tree held up and, you know, with braces and everything else and surrounded with a fence so people don't climb on it. But this has been associated with Abraham, you know, and this location, certainly. But we know somewhere around Hebron, Abraham settled, and the scripture mentions the trees that are there. If you go to Hebron today, it's a little more complicated. The next picture shows you kind of what it looks like, a little bit like today. But today, there are 215,000 Arabs that live in Hebron, and there's less than 1,000 Jews. So it's quite a deal. And there's lots of tension in that city. The first time I visited Hebron was in 1985, and I went in an Arab bus and had a Muslim guide, and no problems. Then we didn't go to Hebron for a long time. And then the next time after that I went, it wasn't on the tour, but I told the people, I want to go. And so I said, I'm going to go. You're welcome to go with me. It's not on the tour, and I can't guarantee your safety. So I rented an armored bus, and I went. But as it turned out, everybody went with me, and it all turned out fine. And now we can go, and you don't need an armored bus, although often, and you don't go if there's trouble, but nonetheless, it's the way it is. But it is a part of the so-called West Bank. But a very small Jewish community there, and it's a troubled history. The recent history is troubled the longer ago. In 1929, there was a massacre of the Jews living in Hebron. Basically, the Arabs tried to kill all the Jews that lived there. Some of them escaped, but anyway, it was a substantial massacre. And there is a small museum there in Hebron that commemorates those who were killed in that massacre. Some years ago, I went to that museum. A group of people went with me from the church here, and I made a brief speech there in the museum. And when I was done, I had invited the spokesman for the Jewish community there in Hebron, and so I invited the spokesman to come up. So our group is there, and they're the ones that I'm primarily speaking to. But the spokesman for the Jewish community in Hebron came up, and I said, I apologize to them for the bad treatment the Jews had gotten there in Hebron, and really throughout the last, you know, probably 1,800 years of history, the Jewish people have been poorly treated by Christians. And most Jewish people actually feel very threatened by Christians, if you want to know the honest truth. They're very suspicious of Christians. And, you know, some of them even blame the Holocaust on Christians, though that would be entirely false. The Holocaust was perpetuated by a pagan. I mean, Hitler, though he claimed Catholic for, you know, credential purposes, was in actual fact a pagan, believed in the pagan gods, was very much into the occult, was probably demon-possessed, was a drug user, was into methamphetamines and other things like that, and he was very likely demon-possessed. But nonetheless, many Jewish people believe that Christians are responsible for the Holocaust. And there have been, you know, going back to the Crusades and other times, persecution of Jewish people by Christians. Now today, many of the leaders of Israel have come to understand that conservative Christians, which I consider myself and you all to be, who believe the Bible, are actually friends of Israel. But this is a surprise to many of them. And I've had the opportunity on a couple of occasions to talk to leaders of Israel about this. I think it was Danny Ayalon, I met with him, the U.S. ambassador, the Israeli ambassador to the United States. I met with him in some law offices down in Seattle. And this was fairly early on. And I said, you know, you people have got to recognize that in America, it's the Christian church that are your supporters, because they would not have recognized that. And I said to them, you know, you're not really taking advantage of that. You are not, you don't seem to recognize that. You don't seem to realize who your friends are. And you should come to depend and recognize this. And I do believe that over the years, they have made progress. It was 3 or 4 years after that that I met with Ehud Olmert, who became shortly after that the Prime Minister of Israel. I met with him in Washington, D.C. There was a group of us at a restaurant, and I said they were trying to abandon Gaza, and I said, you shouldn't do that. And I said, the day will come when your back will be against the wall, but I want you to know that we're going to stand with you. The Christians of America will stand with you. And they are more and more the leaders of Israel, like Netanyahu, I think, has come to understand what good allies they have in Christianity, evangelical Christianity, not liberal Christianity. Liberal Christianity is anti-Israel. It's anti-Semitic. And there are strains within the Catholic Church that are anti-Semitic, unfortunately, though they have apologized for certain behaviors. The Pope did, I think, back in 1967 or something like that. But anyway, so I'm rehearsing some of this in Hebron at the site of the massacre. And so I apologized on behalf of Christians. And And I said, I just want you to know that we stand with you. And so we'd taken up an offering here in the church, and we'd collected about $2,500. And so I took that money with me, and I asked the spokesman to come up, and I peel off 25 $100 bills. And I lay them on the table there, and I say, this is from the people of Cedar Park as an expression of solidarity with you. And I tell you, it was quite a rich moment, because this guy, which I suspect, because the Orthodox Jews in that area honestly don't think very highly of Christians. And my guess is that he would have been quite anti-Christian. That would be my assessment of it. So he says, I make this speech, I make the presentation, and he starts stammering. He doesn't know what to say. And he basically said, you know, I am the spokesman for the Jewish community here in Hebron, and I am supposed to be able to know what to say in times like this. But he said, to tell you the truth, I don't know what to say. He couldn't think of any words to say. And so he stammered out. I mean, he found the words to say. I don't have the words to say. Because I'm sure it was such a shock to him, you know, that Christians would be supportive. And probably to his mindset, it just didn't compute. You know, it didn't make any sense. But he did take the money, and he did eventually say thank you, and that was good. But for me, it's one of those great memories of life, you know, that I like to think about from time to time. But when you go to Hebron today, let me just show you a couple of things here. You know, this we're headed up to the excavations that have taken place in one part of Hebron that goes back to Davidic times, which is important, you know, because in the scripture it says that David was king of Israel, and his first capital was not Jerusalem, but he reigned for 7 years from Hebron. And so to find the place and to do the archaeological excavations, and this location is where they're doing that. The next picture shows you that. These are the excavations from the Davidic era, and they haven't necessarily found the palace and that sort of thing, but they have found many things there. This next picture, the guy on the right is one, that's not the spokesman, but that's one of the settlers there in Hebron. They're a very tough and hardy bunch, that group, because they have quite a bit of pressure on them. This next, I was sounding a little raspy, wasn't I? Yeah. Thank you, sir. You're a kind man. He said, yeah, you were getting a little dry. I can tell that. Thank you very much. I saw Billy Graham do that once, so I know it's okay to do. You like to be named in good company. But anyway, this building, this structure here, as to its primary building, was actually built by Herod the Great, the same guy who mainly built Caesarea, who built the Second Temple, who built the Herodium, who built Masada. Here, he builds this structure, which still exists today, and this structure is built over the cave that has the bodies or the remains, such as it would be dust by this time, 3,800 years later, where Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are buried. So it's called the Cave of the Patriarchs. Next picture shows you just another view of that. That lady on the right, by the way, with what you see wearing a hat, is one of the settlers from this area. And she's actually quite active in churches in America now. She travels a couple times a year to the United States and speaks to churches, though she is Orthodox Jewish. But anyway, her name is Sandra. But this next picture shows you that same edifice there. And the next picture is kind of a close-up. Inside of this structure, today, there are two primary things, one of which is a mosque and the other is a synagogue, and they're in the same building. I mean, they're right there next to each other. This first picture here is the inside of the mosque. You notice on the floor, that's a typical mosque carpet, because each one of those little red spaces marks the spot where a Muslim would kneel. So they all kneel in rows. You ever notice they do that? They all kneel in rows because the spaces are marked out on the floor. And you see the in the background where the imam would stand at the podium there. And of course, every mosque has a niche that faces toward Mecca. But this is the inside of that place. The next picture, which looks quite similar, is the synagogue. You can see a Jewish man praying there, and you can see the Star of David on the podium to the right there, and the scroll cabinet there on the left, and all like that. But you notice that these stone structures are identical, essentially. That red and white is a characteristic Muslim kind of structure. On the outside of the building, there is a particular place that's closest to it. Go to the next picture, if you would, which shows Jewish people praying in that location. But that would be near the spot nearest to the cave. And so Jewish people have made it a place of pilgrimage for millennia of time to go to the place of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and their respective wives. But you also notice the black on the wall. At various times, Muslims have gone there and, you know, set tires on fire and that sort of thing. So there's been a lot of conflict. Now, what's interesting to me is this, inside this very, very important place, there is both a mosque and a synagogue. And that somebody came up with that as an appropriate answer, because I think it's actually a prophetic answer. In the book of Revelation, there is a passage in chapter 11 where it says, I was given a reed like a measuring rod and was told, go and measure the temple of God. This would be Temple Mount in Jerusalem, and the altar, and count the worshipers there, but exclude the outer court. Do not measure it, because it has been given to the Gentiles. They will trample on the holy city for 42 months, and I will give power to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1260 days, clothed in sackcloth. And so the answer that God comes up with for Temple Mount, at the end, in the book of Revelation, when it's restored, is that there will be one place that is given for Jewish people, and there will be another place that's given for Gentiles. And that's what he said. Exclude the outer court. Do not measure it, because it has been given to the Gentiles. What that tells me is when the new temple is built during the millennium, and where this happens in all that time frame, I'm not exactly sure. But there'll be a temple there, and God will say, okay, divide it up essentially into two components. One for Jews, one for Gentiles. The outer court, you know, you've got the court of the inner court, the court of the women, the outer court, you know, the furthermost removed from the tabernacle, or the temple, the Holy of Holies and all of that, that'll be reserved. And I think it's similar to what is in Hebron at the Cave of Machpelah or the Cave of the Patriarchs and the answer that somebody came up with. But it is interesting that a similar description. And, by the way, if I'm right, that the original Ark of the Covenant sat on the flat stone, which is under the dome of the Spirit and the tablets. It's a distance away from where the dome of the rock is. And when you lay over the description of Revelation 11, over the current Temple Mount, what you will see is that the dome of the rock is in the court of the Gentiles, which tells me, if that is still standing, that the actual tabernacle or the new temple, whichever it actually turns out to be, will be centered over the dome of the Spirit and the tablets, and the court of the Gentiles, the dome of the rock, will be given over to Gentiles, which would be me, and you. Most of you are Gentiles, I presume. And there will be special things that Jewish people will do, Christian Jewish people, those special things that Gentile Jewish people do in those alternate places. Now, that's a theory. I can't prove that. But the Cave of Machpelah and what goes on there is what got me to thinking along those lines. So let me do a little bit more about Abraham now in his continuing story. So Lot is down in the Jordan Valley, and he is taken captive. There was a battle with five kings of cities, such as Sodom and Gomorrah, aligned with four other kings who defeated them and robbed their cities. Verse 11, the four kings seized all the goods of Sodom and Gomorrah and all their food. Then they went away. They also carried off Abram's nephew Lot and his possessions, since he was living in Sodom. One who had escaped came and reported this to Abram the Hebrew. Now Abram was living near the great trees of Mamre, or Hebron, the Amorite, a brother of Eshcol and Aner, all of whom were allied with Abram. When Abram heard that his relative had been taken captive, he called out the 318 trained men born in his household and went in pursuit as far as Dan. During the night, Abram divided his men to attack them, and he routed them, pursuing them as far as Hobah, north of Damascus. He recovered all the goods and brought back his relative Lot and his possessions, together with the women and the other people. Hey, Jeff, could you go back? I think it's to slide 27 where I have the map. And I think that's the one. Okay, we'll go that direction. Yeah, here we go. Okay, let's see. Does that have, that has Damascus, doesn't it? Have Damascus? Yeah, there's Damascus. Okay. So this takes place down by the Dead Sea, which can you see where the Dead Sea is over on the left-hand side, just below that bulge in the left road there? There it says Jerusalem, and then down below that, the Dead Sea. Okay, just by the Dead Sea is where Lot is taken captive. Hebron is to the left of that. Do you see it down there, the very bottom? Okay, so Abraham grabs the guys that are in his household, 318 men, servants, kids, grandkids, everybody. No kids, I guess, or grandkids at this point. Yeah, sorry about that. But servants and such. And they head north, and they go after that, and they go all the way to Dan. You see, Damascus is right there above the bubble. Can you see it? Am I talking? Can you see? Can you read it? I mean, the point being, Abraham chases them a long ways. You know, when they talk about the length of Israel, they talk about from Dan to Beersheba. And so he's near Beersheba when he starts out, and he goes past Dan, on into modern-day Syria, past Damascus, and they're still going when he finally catches up to him. I mean, he went a long ways. And he is trying to chase down the people. And this is the first mention we have in the Bible of the city of Dan. So if you could go back through all those pictures, if you would, till you come to the word that says Dan. Some of you are named Dan in this room, to your town. There we go. Stop. Oh, man, I could have used that picture, that map. Okay, go to the next map there. There it is right there. You see Hebron down at the bottom and see Dan way up there at the top in Damascus. It's the full distance that he chases these invaders who had taken off with his nephew Lot. And so they go to Dan. So I'd like to just pause a little bit at Dan and show you that, since I won't be coming back to it any other time, I don't believe. Is that from a lot to northern Israel? Is that modern day Israel? Yeah. So probably in this case it would be, because a lot wouldn't have been part of the ancient or this time. So it's probably like 100 and, is there a chart on that map? You know, someone will Google it and say, how far is it from Beersheba to Damascus? And then you'll know. And someone will have that information in 30 seconds. So let's go to the next picture here. But this is Dan. And this is now a nature preserve. But Dan is one of the headwaters of the Jordan River. In fact, Jordan is comprised of two words, Jor, Dan, which means down from Dan. So the Jordan River is named after Dan, and so it's one of the headwaters there. But there's some nice little streams and pools, and they have fish. I've seen trout in those streams, but you can't catch them because it's a nature preserve, and it's ridiculous. What's the point of having trout if you can't catch them? Okay, next picture. You know, they have... it's a great place to visit. This is as it looks today, the city of Dan and some of the walls from those ancient times. Next picture, I've just got two or three pictures. Look at the people there on the left. You can give you some idea. Look at that people there. Some idea of the scale of the walls of Dan. Go to the next picture there. Dan was the place. That's Pastor Jay sacrificing my son Zach. When they divided up the kingdom, the northern king didn't want the people from his area of Israel going down to Judah. And so his answer was to set up two golden calves, one at Dan and the other at Bethel. I mean, you think about this. They set up golden calves, and there are these altars and sacrifices and that sort of thing. So they've reconstructed this altar out of aluminum, I think that is, or steel. But you're up on the high places of this town of Dan. But they've excavated and done more. The next picture shows you a little bit of the scale of the place. And going back to the time, you know, call it, you know, 900, 800 B.C. is when we're hearkening back to in this location. But in the town of Dan, past which Abraham chases the invaders, go to the next picture if you would. More of that. Next picture, please. So this would be the city gate of Dan. And the city gate, you go up into the city gate, right up ahead, there's like through the opening there, there's where the elders would sit. The elders would sit at the city gate and hold court, essentially. Before they put up those stone walls there on the left, that tree, when they excavated down, I happened to be there before those stone walls went up, and I found a really cool nose off of a giant clay pot. It would be off a pot that would probably this big, and on the bottom they have a nose on them. And I saw it, and I have it. But anyway, it came from right there. You can't get to it now because of that stone. But anyway, that you see that little pedestal there straight ahead? That's where the elders would sit. Next picture shows some of our people coming out of that gate. And, of course, you walk up through there. The next picture is in another part, but this is the oldest arch gate in the world, and it dates to Abraham's time. So when Abraham passed by this area, if he stopped at Dan, which he very likely would have on the way back, if not on the way there, he would have very likely passed through that gate right there. It's the oldest one in the world, so you're talking 3,800 years ago. And the nice thing about Israel is they built that cover is not original, obviously. It's like the cover on this roof here, this roof. But it's to keep those bricks from eroding. And I probably won't discuss anything further on that subject right there. But I could say more, and it would be wise for me not to. I suspect I may have said too much already in this lecture, which I just realized is out there in the world now. But anyway, that's the place right there. That's the place from that goes back to the time of Abraham. So it's 20 minutes till. I think I will pause there and see what questions you have on your mind. If any, did we pass around a sign-up sheet, by the way? Could we do that? Do you have a note? Anybody have a notepad? You'll find one? You have a notepad? Okay. Can you circulate it and just have make sure everybody just signs your name on it? That's all you need to do so that we know that you've been here. We can get a good count that way. So let's take questions. If you are watching online and would like to text a question in, you can go to the Facebook page. Is it going live on Facebook as we speak, Julie? So you can go there and ask your question. It'll get to me. Or you can ask it right here live in front of God and everybody. What we ask you to do is speak loudly and clearly, say your name, and then ask your question or make your comment. So the floor is now open for questions.
Yeah, I have a question. I've been
you
to
didn't say your name.
My name's Tim Campbell. Okay. I've been to Banias, Caesarea Philippi. How close is that to those your photos of Dan?
How close is Caesarea Philippi from there?
Yeah.
It's not that far, because Dan is one of the headwaters of the Jordan. Caesarea Philippi, Banias, is a second headwaters. And so on a typical travel time, touring day, you would go to Dan first, and then you would go to Banias. And so the distance, I don't know, someone will Google it, but I'm thinking it's 20 miles. It's not a great distance. It's not very far at all. It's, 30-minute drive, something like that. Okay, anybody else with a question? Okay, say your name.
Hey, Pastor Joe, I'm David Shin. You mentioned earlier that Islam has its some of its roots founded in paganism, specifically for Sin, the moon god. That's really fascinating to hear. Although I've never read the Quran, is that found in the Quran, or are these from outer historical documents outside of the Quran?
Well, Islam would fiercely debate that, but it's true nonetheless. And it's not found in the Quran that it's associated with the moon god, because Islam prides itself in being anti-paganism. But, the crescent moon, which was the symbol of the moon god, which was prevalent in Arabia at the time Islam was founded, and at Haran, what is the symbol that's on top of the mosque? It's the moon, the crescent moon. And I've written about it a little bit in one of my books called The Revenge of Ephesus, I believe. So if you go online, on the church website actually, go under resources and find my book, The Revenge of Ephesus. And I think there's a chapter there that details a little bit of that. But there's much more that has been written and could be written about the connection of Islam to the moon god and to paganism.
Could I ask another question? Right. So then is that something that's more deeply understood, that may not be as much talked about in Islam? For example, I guess comparison off the top of my head would be the LDS, where there's, on the outside, it looks like it is vocabulary-wise, it's the same as Christianity, but when you find the definition, it's very different. So is it similar to that, where perhaps those higher in the Islamic teaching realm would know about this?
Were you comparing it to LDS, did you say?
I guess it's in terms of like the moon god roots.
Well, as it turns out, there's a lot of similarities between the LDS and Islam. You know, there's the appearance of the angel, which reveals an extra biblical text. It is a highly disciplined religion in one sense and very undisciplined in another sense. You know, multiple wives, this kind of thing. I mean, there are lots and lots of similarities that you can. Moroni is comparable, I think, to the angel that appeared to Muhammad. And so lots of similarities there. But so what was your question again about that? It made the appearance, yes. You know, you could say, I do say, that Islam is a Christian cult. That is, it takes much of Christianity and gives it a different meaning with a new revelation. And so Islam tries to present itself as the true successor to Judaism and Christianity. And that is in the Quran. But there's lots and lots in Islam that tries to look as much like Christianity as possible, except Allah is defined in quite a different way from the Heavenly Father. Although Allah is the name for God, and so it could be applied to God. It's just the Arabic form of that. But still, Islam, certainly in the beginning, but even from time to time now, tries to present itself in that way as a full successor to Christianity. And one of the ways that we've had success in winning Muslims to Christ is to say to them, you believe that Christ is a prophet and what he says is true. And so if that is true, then you should know what he says and you should do what he says. And I'm here to tell you about him. And so that has proved to be an extremely successful entree to Islam and the winning of Muslims to Christ today. And in the place that I'm thinking of, you know, we're past over 40,000 Muslims, including many imams and prayer leaders and sheikhs who have come to Christ. It's quite a remarkable story. Okay?
I'm going back to the Bible.
Start with your name.
I'm going back to the Bible. I'm Elizabeth Patterson.
Did you?
Okay. Elizabeth Patterson, once again. I'm wondering about the story about Lot and his two daughters. It says here in the Bible that Lot went up out of Zoar and dwelt in the mountain and his two daughters with him, for he feared to dwell in Zoar, and he dwelt in a cave, and his two daughters. And the firstborn said unto the younger, it's all about that, when they had that. And then when they had the Ammonites and the Benamis. Do you know the story about what happened to the Ammonites and the Benamis, about the daughters that had the children by their father Lot?
I don't know.
Do you know the story about that? About what
happened
to them afterwards?
I don't know that tribal story. I mean, you could probably just take those two groups, though, and look them up, because
okay.
I have read various places, you know, because Abraham actually had lots of people that would be relatives, and a lot of the tribes, you know, when we talked about who was the group that came in and harassed Gideon, was that the Amalekites?
It was Amalekites.
You know, they are descendants of Abraham. And so there's all kinds of groups like that that are associated, they're relatives, you know, cousins and descendants through various branches, like through Lot and those. I mean, all of those gave rise to tribes which have long histories in the Middle East. I just don't know off the top of my head those two tribes and what ultimately became of them or who they are today, if they can be identified today. I don't know that they can, but I just don't know that information off the top of my head.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Anyone else?
I believe so, yeah. Yeah. Start with your name.
My name's Chris. When I was listening to you talk about the promise from God where the upraised hand, is there other places in the Bible where that type of, you know, description of, you know, human behavior, you know, see what I'm saying? I don't know how to ask that.
So in other words, is it the humanizing of God?
Yeah, that part stuck out to me.
Well, I mean, it could be an idiomatic expression, you know, that, in other words, a very sincere statement.
Right.
With upraised hand. You know, the Father does not have flesh and blood, you know, and so, but on the other hand, Christ is said to be seated at the right hand of the Father.
Right.
So I think that is a way of saying it's that he is in the preferred place, if you will. And so one shouldn't necessarily take that as a literal or human description in the sense that his eyes fell to the floor. You know, you don't look on the floor for someone's eyes. You know, it simply describes position or action or manner. That's the way I would take that. Yeah. Who else has a question? Did everybody get signed in that's here? Did the sign-up sheet make it to you? Anybody not? I guess we did. Not everybody got signed up over here. Is that right? Oh, you're working your way. Okay, very good. Who else has a question? Say your name.
Corey Noblick. Hey, his last question, the day the earth stood still, Jeremiah.
Yeah.
Does that apply?
The day the earth stood still?
Yeah.
I don't know that would. I mean, maybe Chris could comment on that one, actually. Do you have any knowledge of that?
No.
I mean,
His hands up, remember?
Yeah.
And his hands dropped.
Yeah. Do you have any knowledge of that in your apologetic studies? Have you ever come across that? Oh, okay. Yeah. So you can talk about it with him. He's a smart guy. And wave your hand so he knows who I'm talking about. Yeah. But I have read, you know, I have a photographic memory. A lot of people don't know that, but my recall system is broken. So it's all in there. And I know that I've read on that subject, but I just cannot pull it out of my, I mean, I know I read about it. I could even see the book 45 years ago. But I could probably find it in my library, except my library is mostly in boxes right now. So, anybody else with a question that I can actually answer? Or at least make some attempt at?
Dan Berthelsen.
What's your name again? Hi, Dan.
It's where the river flows from. So, if I'm not mistaken, in Genesis, Ham has some sons, and you know the one that got the burden put on him was named Canaan, and he moved to the land of Canaan. You know, the Canaanites, and when Lot was over there, they may have been, I don't know that Abraham, may not have been some of Abraham's relationships in relation to what this lady was talking about over here. They may have been another sect of Ham that was settled over there, what, 1,000 years before that or a few years before that, if we say that there's only a couple thousand years between them.
Yeah. I mean, that could be. I'm just not good on genetics or genealogy, rather. And so I've studied it in only a limited sense of the various genealogies and where they. I have notes from one sermon that I preached years ago somewhere where I tried to trace out some of those tribes. But to tell you the truth, I studied it, wrote it down, and it's gone. But except in my computer.
Ken Short, an answer for the young lady about the Moabites and the Ammonites.
Oh, you found it?
Zephaniah 2:9.
Yeah.
Therefore, as I live, saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, surely Moab shall be as Sodom, and the children of Ammon as Gomorrah, even the breeding of nettles and salt pits and a perpetual desolation. The residue of my people shall spoil them, and the remnant of my people shall possess them.
There you go.
Can't get a better answer than God, can you?
There you go. He knows his genealogies. Yeah, okay. Well, was that the last question or comment? Way in the back. So flying, it's 179 miles from Beersheba to Damascus, and driving, it's 282. And if you're walking, that'd be closer to driving. So, you know, Abraham would have chased them for 300 miles or more. And, you know, 300 miles would be like from here. What is it? 200 miles would be like, say, would that be Salem? How far is it from here to Portland? Is it 200 miles? And it's another 70 miles to Salem. So you're basically from here to Eugene. That's a long ways to walk after somebody. Yeah, that's a long ways to go. All right, let's stand together. Thanks for coming out tonight. What's the topic next Wednesday night there, Chris?
I'm up next Wednesday. The Wednesday following, I have a guest speaker coming in to do a talk on answering evolution. But next Wednesday, I'm going to do a talk on human evolution, the ape men. Look at Neanderthals, Homo erectus, Australopithecines, and how those fit into the biblical view.
Well, I heard it said that we all sprang from monkeys, but some sprang farther than others. But I don't believe even the premise of that statement. So, all right, well, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. I pray, Lord, that if there is a word in what we've spoken tonight that is meant for a person, that it would just find residence in their heart and would become alive in their spirit. For Lord, your word is a sharp sword that is able to communicate to us. And I pray that it would do so in our hearts tonight. Lord, I pray for your peace to be upon each one as we go our separate ways. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you.